The following content has been provided by RWTH Aachen University.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to our second lecture. I hope you all got a seat. We are also still new to RWTH Online, so you should all have fixed plots. Anybody doesn't know what I'm talking about?
How do we know that we got a seat?
You got an email, and in RWTH Online, there's this term fixed plots that actually told you which seat you are. Then you can, after the lecture, come to me and we can look it up. All right, so today we are going to, it's pretty loud. Can we turn it down a little bit?
Yeah,
yes. Here?
Yeah, on the main.
It's better? Yeah. Can you still hear me? All right.
Okay,
today we're going to talk a little bit about the seminar topics, and we will present you the topics, and you can actually vote for the topics. And then we will start by giving you first introduction into Swift, and Philip will later on explain Xcode a little bit for you if you've never seen Xcode or Swift before. So, first question, do you have any experience with programming on iOS? Who did that? Okay, a couple. That's pretty good. Last time we didn't have a lot of people. So what we will start really slow and then we will ramp up the pace over time. So about the seminars, last time I already explained a little bit what the seminar is about, and here we will go a little bit more in detail into what we're going to do in the seminar part of this lecture. So seminars, we have two presentations per session. So you have a 20-minute presentation and we have 10-minute discussion where Philip and I will ask some questions, but also you are encouraged to ask the other people questions. And usually, it's better if you have a couple of questions, otherwise Philip and I will start asking mean questions. So we encourage you to ask your colleagues about these stuff which they present. It will be people of three, so you have a three group, and you can choose how you want to present this in a way. And the dates will be the following. I hope these should be correct. So we'll have 10 lectures now, and then you have the presentation date on these things. So you see, we have 6 dates, so we have 12 groups basically with that's why we have 36 participants in this class. The order and how you will present is not fixed yet, because as we will see, we have more topics than we will actually apply groups. We have 14 topics, and you can choose among these topics. So we'll order this in a way that makes sense, but it a little bit depends what kind of topics you will choose. The structure, yeah, exactly. And what we do usually a week before you present, you will have a discussion with me and Philip about the presentation, about the talk, but we will go into that in detail later on. Exactly, we'll do a slide presentation. We want to see what you're actually doing so we can help you a little bit presenting these things. So the structure of the seminar should be something like you should present an overview over a certain topic. So, for example, if your topic would be ARKit, which is not the case because we covered in the lecture, you should explain what is ARKit, what can you do with it, what kind of application, how you can create the first application with that, and what is actually used for. And what we actually want to get out of these seminars is that you actually show the other people, how can I use this tool? How can I, for what is it good? How can I start the first application with this? Something is ringing, okay. So the structure should be a brief introduction and some basic steps. So first, this is an example application. So this you have to put in code to run this thing. You should have some kind of a live demo. This is not always possible depending on the framework, but you should have something that you can actually show that shows how this system works. What is going on there? And then you should at least explain one or two main or advanced features. For example, ARKit could be something we had last time, face recognition or specific operator recognition and something like this. But we will discuss that in each group individually. And what you have to deliver at the end, you don't have to write a report. What we want from you is the slides, because we want to make it available for the others, because it's part of the oral exam. So they will be uploaded in Moodle, and your demo code, so that people can actually download your code and try it out, because maybe they need that for their project. So what I will do now, I'll go through all these topics now. I will explain a little bit about the topics, and then later on you can set up in groups of three, and then you can actually vote on these things, as I will explain you later on. So the first topic that we will do is SpriteKit. SpriteKit is a 2D game engine 3D game engine designed by Apple. It's basically used for any 2D game, for example, Angry Birds or Flappy Bird or something like that is designed for. It has can do animations, physics, particle effects, and lightning. So this is the first topic we want to learn from this one. However, I will do the presentation. I will do it next week to show you what we actually want from you in the seminar topic. So I will also give a seminar topic to give you a sense of what is interesting, what we actually want to see from you. So this topic's already taken by me. So the next topic is core data. Core data is some kind of the data structure and the back end for data storage in iOS and macOS. It has some, you can see it's not really a database, but it has some kind of functionality to do data persistence, to store data in a persistent way, not only in an app cycle. And there are some ways to work with objects and to exchange objects using these approaches. So it's more about data structure at the back end of your application. If you have any questions for any topic, just ask. So open to answer these things. The second topic is SceneKit. SceneKit is a framework from Apple, which is a very high-level 3D engine. So it has, you can place 3D objects, you have a camera position. So it's similar to Unity in a way, I would say. So, or the typical 3D renderer. So it's very high level, so you have really abstract objects. So for example, if you want to load a 3D object, you can just load the file and you can interact with that. You can do physics, animations. It's based on a scene graph environment, so it's actually a high level where you can do a lot of high level propositions. So I also included some links where I will put the slides online so you can actually see. These are actually talks by WWDC where they talk about these specific topics. So these are the first points where we can have a look at these things as well. So metal, does anybody know what metal is? Everybody heard of this? Kind of? Try to explain it. Could you?
Yeah, it's basically for like DirectX maybe, something similar to basically put objects on the screen, render it on a very low level.
Yeah, exactly. It's the lowest level. Did anybody of you heard from OpenGL? Probably yes. I hope everybody heard OpenGL. This is a replacement for OpenGL. So Apple got rid of OpenGL and replaced it with Metal. It's basically also the organization that designed OpenGL also changed to a different system called Vulkan, which solves a lot of OpenGL problem. And Metal is actually the Vulkan implementation from Apple. So that's why it's called Metal. So it has a lot of things that OpenGL cannot do, for example, multi-threading and a lot of it's actually object-orientated, which was OpenGL is not. And so it has a lot of things that are more modern because OpenGL is 20 years old and a lot of things that were open in OpenGL are not needed anymore. And the best thing about it is actually designed for working exactly on the Apple chip, so they have a lot more control what you can actually do. So if you ever want to implement something that has to be rendered really, really fast in an iOS device, you will probably end up using Metal. So it's pure GPU programming using C++ and shaders and all the fun stuff. If you ever attended computer graphics, you will see that at some point. So it's an interesting topic, but it's something for people who are interested in graphics, basically. Topic four is CloudKit and Cloud Drive. So it's basically how you can use the iCloud, how you can store information in the cloud, how you can store information or across devices, across multiple users, how you can actually, what's the API for that? So basically similar to core data, however, core data is just locally in cloud. CloudKit is basically how you can actually store information in the cloud so that your application can work in cloud environments. The next topic is Core ML and Create ML. These are two frameworks, actually. The first one is running basically a machine learning system. So Core ML uses Metal to run machine learning models on iOS. That's why it's extremely fast. So you can, if you have models, for example, in a typical machine learning environment, you can just load it on your system. It can directly run on a GPU, and that's why it's really fast, because it uses the Metal functionality on a very low-level GPU system to work this. Create Metal is quite new. It's released in iOS It's actually not an iOS application, it's a macOS application. And what you can do with CreateML is you can actually train a model. CoreML can just run models. So you create a model in any application that you know, and you can run it. But with CreateML, it's the approach that you actually can use an Apple framework that allows you to create a very simple model. They have a nice video where you can actually upload hundreds of pictures, and what they do is then let you allow you to create your machine learning approach in a simpler way, however, it still has some limitations. So what one here you see here in this topic is actually show how you create this model and how you can actually run it on your iOS device. So it's a little bit between the Mac and the iOS device in this thing. Next topic is SiriKit. SiriKit is how you could include Siri in your application. What do you have to do for this one? How can your application let Siri run? Specific informations. So typical stuff. The new topic that we included this year is Siri Shortcuts, which is also introduced in iOS 12. And here you can actually create custom shortcuts per user that allow you to do them. So for example, you can ask them, have a command, Siri, order my pizza, and then it knows which pizza it should order. So you can actually create custom Siri commands, but you can also, as a developer, include that in your application to allow these things to work. So this is the question is for Siri shortcuts is how could you include this in your application? Or which framework you have to use, what you have to think about these things. Topic number 8 is WatchOS. So here we want to see you implement what kind of applications you can run on WatchOS, what's the difference, how the iPhone is connected to the WatchOS, what capabilities does the watch actually has, because the first versions of WatchOS only allowed you to run applications while your phone was closed. Now it changed a little bit, so now you can actually use, for example, iTunes to load files on there and go on a run without your iPhone. So it changed a little bit in a way, but however, it's still very limited in its functionality compared to the iOS system itself, because it doesn't really have multi-touch. It just has a couple of very short views and not a lot of all the details that you need. So you want to see what can you actually do with WatchOS now. WatchOS 4 is the latest one, isn't it? Yes. 5, it's already 5. Okay. Yeah, I forgot the numbers. Okay, the next topic is MapKit and core locations. So how can we utilize this? How could you use a map view in your application? How to use core location? What is actually the difference between these two? And how could you, for example, have a navigation system inside your application? For example, I want to go to the Super Safe from here, and how would your application support this? So these are some frameworks here. Next topic, I talked about this a little bit in the last lecture where I said, usually on iOS, you have just one application at one time. However, on the iPad, you can actually have multiple applications at the same time running. And however, your applications, if you want to drag and drop, for example, you want to move this object here, your application have to support this. You cannot just do that for any application. So, and here's the question, how do you have to set up your application in a way that, for example, I can drop an image onto that thing, how to handle that, what kind of calls do I need in my target application to allow this, and also what I need to do in my starting application to allow this. So how can I do that? Topic number 11 is networking. Here we want to know everything about networking that you can think about. So basically, we pointed out three of them. For example, core Bluetooth is how to use Bluetooth to communicate with other devices. Sockets is the typical IP stack that you could use to communicate, but also protocols like Bonjour that allow you to explore what is around in your interface, and we want to see what kind of ways can be used to communicate using network from an iOS device. Topic number 12 is extensions and app integrations. So typical extensions is, for example, you want to design a new keyboard for your iOS device. How can I do that? What kind of extensions are there? Because you cannot just define any extension. Like, you have a lot of hook in points that you can use. Keyboard is one example. For example, stickers in the message thing, photo manipulation, for example. So there are a lot of ways. So iOS does not allow you to do any extension that you like. You have a very limited way how you can do extensions. And we want to see here to the you to show what kind of uses React can do. You should find out two or three example things that you can present. But we also want to do inter-app communication. So for example, you can actually hook into a different app and point them to the right set, so you don't have to start the app from new. For example, this is the banking app for some time that your, for example, the Commerzbank app does that. If you transfer money to that, it actually starts the PIN app, but it also goes to a certain state, so the PIN app can directly confirm that you actually booked something on it. So you can actually hook into multiple applications at different states. That's called deep linking is the nice term for this one from Apple. Topic number 13 is about, not really about applications, but it's more about how to do debugging in Xcode. How to debug an application, how to think about energy efficiency, how to see what kind of, do you have memory leaks, how, what kind of calls that you just made consume a lot of energy. And Xcode has a lot of tools that allow you to do that. There is always this monitor that shows you how much energy you just consume, but you can do also a lot of probing. One application that is there for a long time in Xcode is called Instruments, and it's basically, you can explore almost anything with that. So you can go into every object, you can look at allocations and all of these things, what kind of objects you just created on runtime. So you can explore or have a very good debugging about these things. You can also do something like, if you have a graphics applications, for example, a metal applications, and you get the typical one, my first metal application always have a black screen and you don't know why, you can actually stop the application running and see what's actually going on a GPU to understand. So, for example, it could be that your camera is facing in the wrong direction or something like that. So Xcode has a lot of opportunities to allow you to hook into several levels to actually understand what's currently going on with my system. So it's actually a very useful tool, because if you create an application that drains your battery in 20 minutes, nobody will ever use that. So that's a typical mobile environment problem. So, and the last topic that we have this time is ClassKit. And ClassKit is a new application that is designed for something like this, for school environments, where teachers can actually create applications and students could hook into there. And there's basically a framework around these things to allow you to collect the data or distribute applications and all of these things. So it's quite new and it looks very interesting. And here we want to actually see if you can find something out that maybe we can use next year in our classes or understand what's going on in these things.
This content was provided by RWTH, Aachen University.